Well, hello, everyone. Welcome back to the discussion about Mount Ebal Curse Tablet, which I believe is possibly one of the biggest archaeological discoveries that has happened because of its connection to the biblical account and because of how it changes our whole world of thinking. And I'm so excited to have Dr. Peter Vanderveen and Dr. Scott Stripling back on, and they're in the thick of it. So the question about this curse tablet and where it was placed, and so it's your understanding and your theory, because it came from the up at the top of Mount Ebal, right? This digging, when Adam Zertal was digging, he was sifting through, but he didn't use the technique of wet sifting, so he missed it. And because it also has proto-Sinaitic writing, the early form of Hebrew, and what it says, so we're going to just talk about, what is your theory? What do you think actually happened? Why was that tablet placed there at that location? What was going on in the mind of the person who created this? And the fact that it was the first time you've ever seen one in lead, too.
Well, I'll tell you what my theory was and why we did it, and then maybe Peter can speak to the script itself. The Bible is, in my view, Tim, a reliable historical source. And in many cases, when we're excavating biblical sites, we don't have Mesopotamian literature. We don't have Egyptian literature. All we have is the biblical text. The Bible says that they went to Mount Ebal. Both Peter and I believe that this was around 1400 BC and that Joshua built an altar there. Zertal finds this altar with the round altar underneath it, which we believe dates back to the time of Joshua. And out of that matrix, he finds many things. One of them was this tablet that his team had missed. Fortunately, in his notes, he said the material from the east dump is what came out of the altar. And so we know that's where we were able to retrieve this document. It was a covenant renewal ceremony. These are the blessings that you get for keeping the covenant. These are the curses that are going to inure to you if you violate the covenant. Now, of course, they're all going to break the covenant. That's the sad thing, that at some point they're going to sin. They're going to violate this covenant. Does that mean they're going to be cursed by God himself? I think this is where the symbolism is so powerful, because the tablet is then laid on the altar. What happens on the altar? The shedding of innocent blood to cover the guilty. And so it's through the shedding of blood, Leviticus 17:11, that there is forgiveness of sin. And so this tablet is laid on the altar. So in other words, the man who will own up to his failures will not have those curses inured to him. It's the one who will not that will have to deal with those curses.
So, Peter, give us a little further insight into that. This idea of putting this curse tablet on the altar there, obviously the Israelites would have gone through a number of traumas, as it were, by that time. So what age do you think this tablet is coming in at, first of all? Let's talk about that.
I must admit, before we talk about the what we call Inside B inscription, is that already the people who found it, including Scott Stripling and others, they realized that something had been scratched on the outside. And there were some suggestions whether an aleph, a proto-alphabetic, proto-Sinaitic aleph was found there. They talked about a rosette or a flower, a lily. That was what could be seen, but not more at that time. Once we got the scans from the Czech colleagues from Prague, we had literally many scans, and they needed to be compared because the scans do not always equally show as well all that can be seen in every part of the tablet. You need to compare different scans with each other. Very soon, as Scott already mentioned before, an aleph could be seen, and this aleph was indeed an archaic aleph, which still represents the head of a bull, and that is how we also find it in the Proto-Sinaitic scripts. This type of letter continues during the late Bronze Age, but not later than 1200 BC, which is the time many people believe the conquest actually took place, but that is not the biblical date. The biblical date is 1400.
So what you're saying, let's make a really critical point here, is that what you're suggesting is that a lot of scholars, I think even Adam Zertal, believe the Exodus happened around 1200 BC, and as I always call it, the Ramesses Exodus theory. But what you're suggesting is that this curse tablet is earlier than that. Earlier, possibly to the biblical date.
Yes, the biblical date would be approximately 1400, the Exodus 1445, something like that. Once we started to discover more and more letters, they all turned out to be the very archaic type of letters, which still very much resembled their so-called hieroglyphic prototypes from which they had been derived. Now, this script really is typical of the Late Bronze Age. We have parallel material from Gaza, we have material from Lachish, etc. So we can compare what the letter types were at that stage. And we would argue that this is a sort of intermediary stage between Proto-Sinaitic from the 18th, 17th century and the inscription we find from the Iron Age. So it's something in between. And I think it would be something like 1400, 1350 date that would fit the forms of the letters that we find on the tablet, which is very interesting because this comes very close to the biblical early date of the Exodus and conquest.
Which is amazing. That's why I think it might be one of the biggest archaeological earth-shaking discoveries, right? Because so many people have said the Exodus, first of all, didn't happen, but now here you have this cursed tablet connected also with the Proto-Sinaitic inscription. That's the thing is so powerful about this.
What is very important, and it has not been mentioned so far, we do have words like Arur, to curse, we have Tammuz, you will surely die, and so on. But these words would still also occur in Canaanite inscriptions. These words, in a sense, do not yet prove that the tablet is of Israelite provenance. But what makes the difference is the divine name Yahu, and Yahweh is the God of Israel, and is actually not Yahweh as we would perhaps expect, the tetragram, the four consonants. It is the three consonants, but this is also found in early Israelite monarchic material, like at Kunjulet Acharut around 800 BC. It seems to be the early form of the divine name. It is the name Yahu, which is not found in any known Canaanite onomasticon so far before the Israelite time period. And it's found here on Mount Ebal, which actually clinches it. This text is an Israelite text. And actually, we have two divine names. We have Yahu and we have El. And actually, it's found together, El Yahu, which is very remarkable because liberal scholars would argue that there were different traditions that only at a very late date would come together and would get into the Bible as we have it today. Here we have both names, El and Yahweh, together as the name of one single deity, the God of Israel.
To have the two names, to have it in the earliest form, which we would think Hebrew, to have it at the location and have it at a time. I mean, how can you dispute a lot of that?
It's mind-boggling. You have what's called the documentary hypothesis that began with Wellhausen and then others built upon it. There's other variations of it, but this is what's taught in most seminaries, the JEDP concept, that the J source and the E source are hundreds of years apart. And therefore, the Bible could not have been redacted in its final form until 1,000 years later or so. This proves that's not true. We have the J and the E side by side here.
For those who don't know what the documentary hypothesis is that Moses didn't write the Bible because they were seeing different names for God, and they were trying to suggest that there were different authors later that invented a history. But this inscription actually refutes that.
And let me say one more thing, Tim. There's only one group of people in the ancient world worshiping Yahweh, and those are Israelites. And so while we've thrown around terms like Proto-Sinaitic and Proto-Canaanite, Proto-Alphabetic, which is a more generic term, which we've used in our article, but nobody had the guts to call it Proto-Hebrew because nobody wanted to be criticized so immensely, you know? But here, you can't call this anything but that. We'll be more general in our article and we'll call it proto-alphabetic. But once you get us all off the beaten path, there's no doubt it is definitely proto-Hebrew script.
When we come back, we're going to come back again. We're going to be talking a little bit about what does this curse say. We'll come back in the next segment and we'll be talking a little bit about that.